Lord, I thank you. I feel your presence. I feel your presence all the time. But I feel like you've come close to the house of peace. I feel like you are in the room. You always are in the room, but you came and sat next to me. God, thank you, Lord, you're here. And God, you have something for your people today. You have something for your people today. You're going to liberate people today. You're going to liberate people this evening. You're going to liberate people tomorrow and next week and next year. You're going to use this message, God. Lord, not because I am the one that's giving it, but because it's your word. It's your anointed word. In Jesus' name, amen and amen and amen. Come on, let's give the Lord a hand clap. All right, are y'all ready? Come on, share this service with somebody. Somebody need to get this. Share it now. Share it later on this evening. Share it with somebody. Share it with somebody. Please, you're going to take notes. I want to encourage you that I have a lot of scripture and a lot of other things that I'm going to be giving, and you need to take pictures of certain things because there's so much scripture that I have that I can't quote everything, so I just wrote the scriptures there. So, hallelujah. Are y'all ready? Say, Pastor, I am ready to eat. Hallelujah. Let's do it like this. I am ready to feast. Come on, somebody taste that. I'm ready. I typed that. I'm ready to feast. Amen. Now, today, I'm going to be continuing on with my series of teaching that I started last week entitled God's Prescription for Life. God's Prescription for Life. Now, in order to paint a clear picture of why I entitled this God's Prescription of Life, I use the analogy of what is a medical prescription. What is a medical prescription? And why do people take medications? I said that a lot of prescriptions often are abbreviated with the thing what? RX. Okay? All right, RX. Everybody say RX. X-Men. And it's a formal communication from a physician or other registered healthcare profession to a pharmacist authorizing them to dispense a specific prescription drug for a specific patient. Now, these drugs are used to what? To diagnose, cure, treat, or prevent diseases. I also said the medications prescribed always have instructions on the bottle that tells us how to take it, okay? And how much to take. Now, the bottle may read, take one tablet every 6 hours, or take one pill 3 times a day, or take one pill in the morning and one pill at night with your food. Now, if we don't follow the instructions, we can get into trouble. We can take too much or not enough of the medication. Amen? Or we can take it too often and not enough. Now, with medicines, we must take it according to the doctor's prescription. We must take it according to the doctor's prescription. Now, it would only be effective if we take it properly. It would only be effective if we take it properly. Then I told you that we should do the same thing with prescriptions that God has written for us. I mean, you know, that God has prescribed a prescription for our life. Proverbs, it says this. It says, my son or my daughter, my son, give attention to my what? To my what? Words. Incline your ear to my sayings. Do not let them depart from your what? Your sight. Keep them in the midst of your heart, for they are life. You hear what it says? For they are life to those who find them and health, hallelujah, to their body. Amen. That is so powerful, isn't that? You see, we need to pay close attention to God's word. And we need to adhere to it in every aspect of our lives. But the question is, are we really prepared or willing to do what his prescription actually says? Because if we do what his prescription actually says, this will mold our belief system for life that is a link that ties trust and faith together. Now, last week, I told you the story in order to illustrate what I'm talking about when it comes to your belief system and when it comes to faith and trust, okay? Because I often say there are a lot of people, we agree with the word, but we don't apply the word. You remember the story of the great Blondine? Blondine was a tightrope walker whose greatest stunt was walking on a tightrope across the Niagara Falls pushing a wheelbarrow. Now, I said before he began his wheelbarrow stunt, he would ask the watching crowd if they believed that he could do it. And everybody said, yeah, you can do it. You can do it. You're going to do it. But after the stunt, after he was successful with it, he would ask them if anyone would sit in the wheelbarrow as he pushed it along the tightrope. Nobody would say anything. And that's where a lot of people, talk is cheap. Talk is cheap. Amen. Talk is cheap. Amen. Amen. Talk is cheap. Nobody would say a word. And we learn from this that we must decide that if we believe the word of God as it is, and that it applies to us in every area, every aspect, it applies to us. Now, how can we get God's words, thoughts, and beliefs about ourselves? You hear what I said? About ourselves. And how God sees us to line up with his word, okay? We got to line up. You got to line your life up with his word. You got to have principles. It's got to line up with his word. And when your life line up with his word, everything God's prescription for health is going to work, okay? And how can we believe the word we tell ourselves and shore up our faith so that it doesn't crash or burn frequently? You see, Jesus alone carries the power to transform what we see, what we think, what we speak, and believe about who we are, okay? About who we are. See, when we cry out to Jesus with sincere hearts, he never fails to graciously lift us up with his loving hands. We sung that song, I Can't Give Up Now. Amen. I come too far for where I started from. Hallelujah. Nobody told me that the road would be easy, but hallelujah. But I don't believe that you brought me this far to leave me. Amen. Now, I said that we can begin the process of revelation and transformation by taking God, by talking to God and asking Jesus, how do I allow the word of God to change how I feel about myself? I need y'all to get that. How do I allow the word of God to change how I think about myself? And how do I see your word as more than just a word on a page, but words that impact and empower us as I speak themselves to myself? Sometimes I like to just read the word out loud. Amen. I just like to read the word out loud so I can hear myself reading it. Amen. You see, when we do this, God gives us new clarity when we come to him. When we begin to see life, we'll begin to see life a whole lot better. We'll see ourselves. See, you got to see this. Okay? We'll see ourselves. Say, myself. We'll see ourselves. We'll see our problems. We'll see our past. We'll see our present and our future. Everything gets a little clearer and closer when you get to God. When you get to God. That's because God's prescription for our lives has been filled through the life and death of Jesus Christ. But what will we do with his prescription? How many of you ever got a prescription that the doctor asked you to take and you say, I ain't taking that. I don't care what he say. I'll get it filled, but I ain't going to take it. And it's still sitting up in the cabinet right now. Come on, sister. No, I'm sorry. it's still sitting up in the cabinet right now. I ain't taking none of that. Amen. Amen. Doctor said, well, how you doing on the prescription? Ask me no questions. Tell me no lie. I tell you no lie. Amen. Amen. Now, I want to encourage you that if you didn't hear that sermon last week, please go back and look at it on Facebook or YouTube or the link that we sent you. Or please go back because it's important, it's imperative that you do that. Amen. Now, I would like to start part two of this anointed message by asking you two questions. These are the two questions that I want to ask you. Who are you? Who are you? And how do you see yourself? I want that to sink in. Would you just say with me, who am I? And how do I see myself? Let me say it again. Who are you? And how do you see yourself? Are y'all with me? Now pause for a moment and think about it. What thoughts have you had about yourself today? What thoughts have you had about yourself last week? What thoughts have you had about yourself last month? What thoughts have you had about yourself? I want you to think, because this is a thinking message. If you're going to be transformed, you got to think. What thoughts have you had about yourself today? Now, I went out and I purchased these mirrors, and I was going to buy, you know, the little mirrors that you can get one for a dollar or 50 cents. God said, nope. He said, I need you to buy something that's going to be big. So take it out. Take it out. Open it up. Hold it in your hand. If you need to hold it like this, you need to hold it like that. Don't turn it on the white part like you're playing, like you're looking at yourself. Okay? Now, watch this. Because you got to get this. You got to get this. Listen to what I'm getting ready to say. I want you to look in that mirror. Look in it. I don't want you to just look at your face. I want you to go down. I try to buy them big enough. I want you to look at yourself. Just look at yourself. Please, take the time to look at yourself. And keep looking at yourself. Now I want to ask you a question. Keep looking at yourself. Keep looking at yourself. What do you see? Okay? Keep looking at yourself. Don't make no comments. But what do you see? What do you see? Everybody looking? Everybody, come on, hold your mirror up so I can see it. You got yours? Come on, look at yourself. Yeah, I want you to look at yourself. I'm looking. I'm looking to see who ain't looking. I want you to look at yourself. That's right. Okay? Now, some of you would say jokingly, I see myself, of course. I see me. Okay? But the question is, what is yourself? Keep looking. Come on. What is yourself? Keep looking. What is yourself? Keisha, turn that thing around. I see you. What is yourself? Okay. Oh, you know what? Take that mask off. That's right. Take that mask off for a second. Come on. We're going back. See, y'all hiding some stuff. So now I got to go back and ask you, what do you see? Take your mask off. That's right. Take it off for a second. Now look at yourself. Come on. Look at yourself. Look at yourself. Look at yourself. Now, I know I'm spending some time on this, but this is important. This is the crutch of the message. I want you to look at y'all. Y'all looking at yourself? All right. All right. So the question is, what is yourself? You can put the mask back on. What is yourself? Listen to what I'm getting ready to say, because this is going to be very profound. What is yourself? If you're watching by live stream, that's right. Look in that mirror. Some people, oh, no, I ain't looking at it. I ain't properly dressed. You're the only person in the room, so, yeah. What is yourself? See, strictly speaking, when you look in a mirror, you see a face that you recognize as your what? As your own. Now, this in and of itself is a remarkable feat. You know what? Other animals generally can't do this. When they look in the mirror. For instance, a dog looking in the mirror, guess when the dog looks in the mirror, what do they see? They see another dog. Okay? They don't know that's them. Okay, and they'd be like, they'd be going crazy. Amen. When they look in the mirror, they see another dog. At least that is what we infer from observing their behavior. Now, question. What do you see in the mirror? Describe yourself in one sentence. What do you see? If you want to write on the back of there or whatever, what do you see? Or write it on your paper. What do you see in the mirror to describe yourself? Be honest. Because you know what? The Bible says, behold, thou desire truth in the inward part, and you make known to me wisdom in the hidden part. And if you can't be honest with yourself, you can't get deliverance. What do you see? What do you see when you look in that mirror? I'm not talking about your makeup. Not talking about your eyelashes. Not talking about your hairstyle. What do you see when you look in that mirror? One sentence, just one sentence. One sentence, or if some of you got a paragraph, I don't know, but what do you see? What do you see? I'm taking my time here. What do you see when you look in that mirror? What describe yourself. You see, am I really seeing me when I look at myself every day? I want y'all to think about this. Am I really seeing me when I look at myself every day? Or am I thinking of myself critically? Always focusing on my flaws, my imperfections, and even my childhood self or my childhood hurts. Am I treating myself as a real person with legitimate needs, a unique personality, the true gifts to offer the world? Am I a blessing to the world, or do I feel so insignificant that when I get around significant people, I feel insignificant? Or am I gazing over when I look at myself? See, I looked at some people you gazed over. You wanted to look at your hair. You wanted to look at your eyelashes, but you really wasn't paying attention to the real self. So am I gazing over when I look at myself, dismissing this person, me, as someone that I don't really need to pay attention to? You see, you don't pay attention to yourself when you got issues and you won't deal with those issues. So you're really not paying attention. Are y'all with me? Do I really know myself? Do I really know myself? Do I really value myself as God values me? Do I take myself seriously? You know, a Dutch bicycle manufacturer, Van Moof, had come up with an ingenious idea for ensuring that its product is safely transferred to its customer. Okay? So they were in another country. Now, Oddity Central report, Van Moon plans to sell 90% of his bicycles online by 2020. But after seeing a considerable number of products getting damaged during the deliveries and incurring serious losses, the company was left with two options. To rethink its business plan, or to come up with a better effective solution, because most of their bikes were being damaged in shipping. Now, luckily, they managed to come up with something so brilliant that it's bound to be copied by other companies that rely heavily on online sales. How many of you ever got something, and when you got it, it was broken? I thank God when I ordered all these mirrors, not one of them was broken. Thank God. But I was concerned. You understand? But so they said most of their products were being broken, being shipped from overseas. Okay? All right, now watch this. They were selling bicycles, but they were broken. They were broken. Now watch this. Creative director Rex Rad wrote on the company blog, earlier this year, our co-founder, Ties, have had a flash of genius. Our boxes are about the same size as really, really, really massive, because it's a bike, okay? It's the same size as maybe a 75 to 80-inch flat screen television. You say, what that got to do with that? Now watch this. They said, what if we just printed a flat screen television on the side of the box? Watch this. Look at this creativity. Most people would think what? It's a TV in the box, and they're going to handle it with what? Care. But in actuality, it's a bike in there. Look at that creativity. Look at that creativity. Now, so by simply printing a flat screen TV on the box, watch this. That reduced the rate of damaged goods by 70 to 80%. By simply putting a TV on the box, even though it was a bike in the box. And they're not lying. That's not discriminatory, is it? Because they got the bikes there. Amen? Amen. And I like what it said, outsmart the city. Now watch this, watch this, watch this. What's the moral to the story? That's the question. What's the moral to the story? Listen to me. Listen to this. Because you just looked at yourself in the mirror. You just looked at yourself in the mirror. Now watch this. Watch this because you got to get this. You got to get this. You got to get this. Watch this. You got to get it. What's the moral to the story? When we value what's in the box, we treat the box with greater care. Did y'all hear what I just said? When we value what's in the box, we treat the box with greater care. Now you're the temple of the Holy Ghost. You're the temple of God. And some of us, we're not treating ourselves the way we should be treating ourselves because we don't value what's in the box. We don't value what's in the box. Why is this so important? Because look at this. This is so powerful. Why is this so important? You want to take a screenshot of that. You want to take a screenshot of that. Okay? I'm giving you some things. That's why God said, I can't do this in two sessions. I have to go another session. Okay? Look what it says. Who you see yourself to be determines, listen to this, who you see yourself to be determines your level of faith, according to Numbers chapter 13 and 14. And I'm giving you the scriptures so that you can go back and read, okay, where the children of Israel's level of faith was when they saw the giants in the land. Okay? And they couldn't fulfill what God told them to go in and take possession of the land because of where their level of faith was. Okay? So it's important, who do you see yourself? Watch this. It determines your depth of confidence. Even in adverse situations, how confident you are when things are not going the way that they should. It determines your scope of accomplishments. Okay? What have you accomplished in life? Or do you feel like you have failed at more things than you have accomplished? It determines your experience of security. You know, and all those scriptures that I gave you, John 6:35, John 8:12, John 10:7, John 11:25, John 10:14, John 14:16, John 15:1, all of them starts with I am. What Christ said about himself and what he says about you. I am. Who do you see? See, your sense of emotional health. See, some people, they're spiritual, but they allow their soulish man to override their spirit man. Okay? Your sense of emotional health, according to 2 Corinthians 10, verses 3 through 5, and Romans 14:7. And then even your walk of freedom. Do you feel free? You know, some of us, when people say good things about us, we have a hard time accepting what they say because we don't feel what they say about us. And we shy away from it. Okay, John, according to 8, John 8, 30 through 32. John 8, 30 through 32. And your need for purpose. Everybody needs to have purpose. Everybody needs to have purpose. Let me say this. Even Jesus was challenged with the question, who am I? In his temptation in the desert in Matthew chapter 4. If you be the Son of God. He was questioned, who are you? Who are you? I need y'all to get this. This don't need to be a message that when you leave here, you go about your other things of life, but this should resonate. Who am I? And you need to be asking yourself that question. Who am I? Who am I? You see, in a nutshell, this is what God says about you in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10. Look what it says. He says this, for we are God's masterpiece. Would you say that with me? We are God's masterpiece. If you're online, say, I want you to type, we are God's masterpiece, or I am God's masterpiece. Now, I didn't say it. He said it. And look what he says. He said, not only are you his masterpiece, but he has created us anew in Christ so that we can do the good things he planned for us long ago. Let me say this. There is greatness in you. And some of you don't believe it. That's why you struggle with your marriage. You struggle with people. You struggle with a lot of things, with problems. There's greatness in you. I always like to tell the story when my mother had me. She was 19 when she had me, got pregnant when she was 18. And she was from Clarksdale, Mississippi. All right, and she had moved to Chicago because the jobs, you know, were plenteous. And she got with the wrong guy. Okay, and had, you know how they tell you they love you, and then when you tell them you're pregnant. And my mama told me this story just about maybe 3 months ago. She said, you know, your biological daddy, the court asked and said, what you going to do about this? You ought to marry her. And he didn't say anything. And she said the judge put him in jail. It's 1961 or 62 because I was born in December. Put him in jail for a while, a day or two. But my mother was feeling like she is a young lady, 19 years old, in a city, don't have a job, or she just started a job, and she didn't have nobody to watch me. And she said that when she was on the bus, she didn't know what she was going to do with me. And she said she looked at the Chicago River as she was passing, and the devil spoke to her and said, why don't you take that child and throw him into the river? Come on, can I be real with y'all? Then you can go on with your life. But then she caught herself and she said, I didn't know that this masterpiece, this child that God had planned long ago, even though he was born out of wedlock, would save our family, would break generational curses over our family, and lead us to God. She said, I didn't know I had God's promised child. Listen to me. Why is this possible? Because of Christ. Because of Christ, I am God's masterpiece. I am God's masterpiece, an ever-changing work of art that is displayed on the world of his glory. Look, think about the Mona Lisa. Man, the Mona Lisa was painted by paint. But this thing, I think it's worth like $100 million. It's a masterpiece, but it's paint on a canvas. A canvas. But because it's a masterpiece, they have it in thick glass and they guard this thing. Think a masterpiece. I'm trying to get you to understand. You are a masterpiece. I don't care what you've been through. You are God's masterpiece. I am God's masterpiece, an ever-changing work of art on display in the world for his glory. Not only to me, but you, not only me, but you are God's masterpiece. Now, masterpiece is found in the New Living. I just read that from the New Living Translation. It said his handiwork, you know. It might be slightly over-translated in the Greek original, but it rightly conveys something about the nature of the new creation in Christ. See, after all, God doesn't make damaged goods or mediocre products. You know, when he made you, he didn't make you damaged. I need y'all to get this. He didn't make you damaged. Whatever God makes could, in a real sense, be called a masterpiece. Now, I realize, let me be honest with you. I realize that you might not feel like a masterpiece today. You may not feel like a masterpiece today. You may be feeling like something far less than this. Perhaps your body is aging and you're struggling even to do things that you did without a second thought, and you don't feel like a masterpiece. Can I get in your space? Can you allow the Holy Spirit to get inside? Amen. Or maybe you be sensing your morals or your relational failures. You have failed at so many things in life and you can't get past that. Or maybe you're struggling at work, or maybe sometimes you allow your human frailty to get in the way. Therefore, most days, feeling like a masterpiece is hardly the way we describe ourselves. Maybe you're grieving. You're grieving, and you're trying to find your way through that grief and that pain and that hurt. And you don't feel like a masterpiece. Instead, every tiny flaw seems to jump out at us. We want to nitpick the imperfections, the ugly, and the scars that we bear from hurt, pain, abuse, disappointment, broken relationships, separation, divorce. Sometimes our souls become weary. Come on. We become weary from pushing on through the struggles, and we want to run away from our troubles and not let them perfect us. You know, James tells us in James 1, verses 2 through 4, about how the fiery trials are what? They're supposed to what? Bring perfection in us, to help us. But sometimes when we look at the tragedies and the everyday bumps and bruises, we don't want to believe that. I don't want to believe that I'm a masterpiece. I don't feel like I'm a masterpiece. Look what it says in Romans. And we know that all things. I'm glad he put the all in there. I'm glad he didn't say, and we know that in things, but he said in all things. God works for the good of those who love him, who are called according to his what? Now watch this. Listen to what I'm getting ready to say, because this is real. If we are not focused some days, as we watch our troubles mount to an almost unbearable weight on our shoulders, we'll just want to be taken away to somewhere quiet where we can be just be left alone. I don't want to be bothered with nobody. I don't want to hear nothing. I don't want nobody praying for me. I don't want nobody. I don't want nobody to tell me it's gonna be all right. I'm hurting. Come on, can I be real with y'all? But thank goodness that our life's foundation, look, our life foundation doesn't have to be based on the fluctuation of our feelings or even the reality of our circumstances. Thank goodness that God can see through the nastiness of our world, both our difficult circumstances and our selfish desires, and somehow, some way, transform them into a breathtaking cascade of his glory. You know, every now and then, I like to read people's stories, or I like to hear your story. When I first meet you, I say, tell me your story. Tell me what you've been through. I don't want to hear about your victories first. No, I want to tell me about your struggles and how your struggles led to your victory. We all have struggles. And yes, sometimes we can get back and look, or we can step back and we can look upon everyday trials and see the masterpiece slowly taking place with how God is developing me into a masterpiece. So I know I'm a pastor among pastors, because pastors always tell me that. Young pastors, older pastors, prophets, pastors, apostles, teachers. They look at me that way. Uh-oh, look good here. Let's see what happened here. All right, we back. Amen. Watch this. That makes all the uncomfortable shaking worth it. I don't believe you brought me this far. See, my answer is that your status as a masterpiece is true, not because of how healthy you are, how much you have accomplished, or how moral you are, but you are a masterpiece because what God has done in your life by his grace. You are a masterpiece because of what God has done in your life. Let me say it again. By his grace, you have been newly and wonderfully created through Christ so that you might live in right relationship with God for his glory. You know, it's amazing. That the only scars in heaven, because they're going to be, and it's not going to be your scars. It's going to be his scars. Because the lamb, he still shows the wounds. That's amazing. When we get to heaven, no more pain, no more sickness, no more sorrow, no more hurt, no disappointment. But God says, one thing I'm going to leave. I'm going to show you the wounds of my son to remind you where I brought you from. Now let me move on. Apostle Paul said this. He says this. And you were dead in your trespasses and sin. But then came grace, as is mentioned in Ephesians 2:8. Look, I think about Ryan when he first came. Broken. On dialysis because of drugs. Seen his mother shot down. And see her in the street bleeding, right? And then to find out it was a hit. And where it drove him to. And the thing that he had to live with, when my mama asked me, could you walk me to the bus stop? And he said, maybe if I had walked her to the bus stop, she still would be living. But not if he had walked into the bus stop, they probably both would have been dead. Pain. Can I be real with y'all? Pain. Pain will drive some people to drinking, to a life of alcohol and crime, to a life of immorality, to a lot of things. Pain! Can y'all hear me? Pain! Ephesians 2:18 says, for by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not of your own doing. It is the gift of God. I remember that day he was so distanced that the person had invited him. I walked up to the car, and he was so short-stemmed with me. Off. But then that day he heard the word. He heard the word. And it transformed his life. And this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God. You see, when we continue, listen to me. When we continue to depend on the Holy Spirit for guidance, listen, because most of us, we only depend on the Holy Spirit when we messed up, and then we want to try him. But when we depend on the Holy Spirit for guidance, for power, and direction, we will see the old ways of thinking, believing, and start living transformed. We'll be transformed into new ways of promises of Christ. Watch this. You got to get this. When we make that connection, we will start seeing ourselves as more than conquerors. The average Christian don't see themselves as more than conquerors. Because like I said, this pandemic revealed a lot of things about a lot of people. A lot of people were tired and burned out. We can't take away from that. Because there were a lot of people that were just tired and just burned out. And they were just looking for a way to leave. Okay? And some of them, we just got to pray for. We got to love on them and believing that, you know, that they would find their joy again. Look what it says here. And I'm almost closing. Look what it says here in Romans chapter 8. And this is going to be next week because we got to talk about what it does it mean to be more than a conqueror. But I want to give you just a snippet of this. It says in Romans 8, 35 through 7, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship, persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. But even though all of that's happening, everything you've been through, every hurt, every disappointment, every pain, every verbal abuse, every physical abuse, whatever financial difficulty, born out of wedlock, being born in poor circumstances, everything, you say no. In all these things, we are more than conquerors through him that loves us. Now watch this, because I'm getting there. When Christ comes in your life, listen. Now I have to use this word because I don't see a lot of people living it. When Christ comes into your life, things are supposed to be different. Okay? It's supposed to be different. That's because a new life has begun, what? Spiritually. The old is gone. And the new has come. Now, your mind is one of the most powerful and creative tools that God has given you to shape your reality. Your mind. Everybody say your mind. Okay? It shapes your reality. Your mind shapes your thinking, shapes your reality. It influences your life. okay? And if you really are attached to Christ, I mean yielding, he will make your mind, make you believe, and will be more than a conqueror. We got a lot of people grieving in our church. And it's all right to grieve. It's all right to mourn. It's all right to hurt. But even in the midst of that, you're still more than a conqueror. Son, the S-U-N may not seem like it's shiny, but the S-O-N is always shining. And he will bring you through the valley of the shadow of death. It may not be over in a week. It may not be over in a month. It may not be over in 2 months or 3 months. But he's going to bring you through it. You see, most believers simply allow their thoughts to happen. You just allow your thoughts to happen. And rarely paying attention to what you're thinking about. We rarely think about what we're thinking about. See, you can say one thing to me. I've asked people, are you all right? Oh, I'm all right. No, you're not all right. Stop lying to yourself. You're not all right. It's all right to say I'm not all right. Let alone taking authority over their thoughts, lives, and bringing them into alignment. See, we don't bring our thought lives into alignment. You know why we don't bring our lives, thought lives into alignment? Because we try to spiritualize everything. If I'm hurting, I'm hurting, but I'm not going to always hurt. But right now, I'm hurting. If I'm grieving, I'm grieving. But right, you understand what I'm saying? If I'm disappointed in something, yes. But you see, we spiritualize everything. But you got to bring your thoughts into alignment with God. Because you're saying one thing, but you're doing another. Look what it says in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 5. We demolish what? Arguments and every, what, pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God. God don't love you. God don't care for you. God not meeting your need. If he loved you, why he letting you go through all these problems? If he loved you, why did he allow that loved one to pass away? You're just wasting your time with that Christianity. It ain't doing nothing for you. Sets itself against the knowledge of God, and we take captive every thought and make it obedient to Christ. Listen, there have been times that I have felt beaten down. Come on, can I be real? There are times I have felt like I've been beaten down, like I was carrying the weight of the world on my shoulders. There have been times when no matter how hard I tried, it didn't just seem to be working the way I believed God or the way I wanted it to go. There have been times when I wanted to give up and just walk away. You see, it seems like it's easy if you only have yourself to worry about, especially when it comes to ministry work. But I don't even have time just for myself because I'm on the roller coaster with everybody else. But when I read Romans 8, 35 through 7, I am reminded that regardless of what I experience, God has already made me victorious because of the love he has for me. And verse 35 reminds us that nothing can separate us from the love of Christ. Why is that important to understand? Okay, I'm wrapping this up. Why is that important to understand? Watch this. In war, one of the tactics of the enemy is to cut off the supply line so that he can separate the soldier from the supplies necessary to carry on the battle. Now, when soldiers become isolated from their supplies, their morals become low, and oftentimes they end up losing the battle. Now, in these verses, we find that nothing can separate us from our supply line but you. What we need in order to be victorious is guaranteed to be full, to be in full. Uninterrupted abundance. Because I'm connected to Christ, this connection cannot be broken by the enemy. I'm connected, and it cannot be broken by him. I'm learning to see myself as the victor and not the victim. I'm learning to see myself as the victor in the battles of life. Because I got them. I'm going to have them. But I see myself as the victor. I said, God, I don't have no other way to live. I have no other place to go. You are the answer. And I know you're going to get me through this. I'm not a loser. Some of you felt like you've been losing during this pandemic, during your grief. I'm learning to carry myself as one who is victorious and not as one who is in constant state of defeat. Yeah, these 2 years, 2.5 years have made people feel like they're in a constant state of worry. COVID. I'm going to get COVID. I'm going to die from COVID. And my loved one's going to die from COVID. Philippians says this, whatever you have, learn to receive. Listen to me. Listen to this. This is what the Lord told me, the last scripture, and he said this. Listen to me. I need you to see this. I need you to see this. Okay, I just gave you the word of the Lord. I'm done. I gave you the word of the Lord. Now, listen. Look at this scripture. Look what it says, and this is Paul speaking. He said, whatever you have learned, what did you learn? God's prescription, what? For life. And we're going to talk about next week about what it means to be more than a conqueror. Okay? He said, whatever you have learned or received or heard from me or seen in me. Okay? All three of those things, if you know me, you have learned and received, and you have heard from me, and you've seen in me. Now, this is where the rubber meets the road, whether you're going to change. Because change has to happen. You can't keep being a procrastinator. You can't keep making excuses for why you're not who you're supposed to be. You can't keep doing it! I tell my wife sometimes, I say, babe, I'm your husband, but yet I'm your pastor too. And you got to know when I'm talking to you as your husband and when I'm talking to you as your pastor. That's right. So when I tell people, so that's good enough for my wife, why shouldn't it be good for you? And yeah, she put up a fight. She put up a fight, but I said, I'm talking to you as your pastor. Look what it says. Everything that I've said, it said, do what? Put it into what? He said, put it into practice. But George, look at this. This is the most powerful thing. When you take what I've given you today, see, you got to start doing some research. Who am I? Ask yourself. How did I get liberated? I didn't love myself. How did I get liberated? I was angry at God. How did I get liberated? I was born out of wedlock. How did I get liberated? I was born in poor circumstances. How did I get liberated? I had a lot of issues going on in my life. And I had to say, God, okay, I can't do it on my own. And these things do affect me. How did I get liberated? being born out of wedlock and having three stepfathers. How did I get liberated? I had to acknowledge these things and the pain that it caused me and what I felt like, even though I was saved. I didn't love what I saw in the mirror. I didn't think I deserved to have somebody like Sister Carmela coming from the typical American family with the two cars, the motorhome, the dog, the mama stay at home. The father worked two jobs. And I came from the Pookie. I felt like the Pookie and the Ray Rays. Come on, God, that don't seem like a perfect match. Can I be real with y'all? Look what it said. If you start from this day to say, God, I need some time alone with you, and I'm going to start taking a journal, I'm going to start thinking about why I'm angry, or why do I do this, or why do I do that, or why do I don't want people to be close to me, why do I always stress? You got to start writing these things down. Get you a prayer journal. And look what it says. It says, when you put them into practice, look what it says. And the God of peace will be with you. That's where your peace is. Is everything in my life in order right now? Nope. But I'm a conqueror. Because it will be. It will be. Can we stand? It will be. I need you to make a commitment to God. I need you to make a commitment to God, not to pastor, not to pastor. This is not a commitment to pastor. This is a commitment to God. That God, if I have to go back and listen to this, if I have to go back and read all those scriptures about the failure of God's people. Do you know the Bible is a Bible that does not talk about the failures of the world, but it talks about the failure of God's people? But yet it talks about the victory of those that overcame by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. Are y'all with me? Yes, sir. Prophesied to a brother this morning. He says, I was just praying that this morning, and you prayed it. Stop pretending to be something that you are not. Get it under the blood so that you can truly be who God says you are. Some of you got issues in your marriage. You got issues with your husband or your wife. You got issues with the way that you your money, how you do your bills. You got issues with health problems and you got issues. You got issues how you deal with your health problems. You got issues. You got issues with family relationships. Can't be in the same room with some of your relatives. I came to you sometime, but I have to be Christ-like. That's what get me through it. You got issues which would hurt. You got issues. You got issues. And I'm telling you, if you just take this message and you leave this room and you don't ask yourself, okay, God, Pastor, God used Pastor to stir something up in me. And now I got to lift up the tablecloth and see what's there. See, I'm so used to doing everything. Oh, man, I gotta be laying hands on people and people falling out into spirit and everything like this. Right now, that can happen. But if I laid hands on you, when you walk out this door, is there transformation? Or I'm going to pray, and I want you to pray. I want you to pray. I want you to pray. And you know, laying hands is good. I'm not taking away from that. But God is saying, son, the reason that I have you in your element, you're not a preacher of preachers when it comes to preaching. Say, you're a teacher, and that's where I want you to be. And I want you to preach messages. If it lasts a month or 3 months or 2 weeks, he said, you got to get this. People got to change. The preachers got to stop feeding people. And preaching people into a frenzy. And this word's got to change. You know what? I'm trying to end this. But this is a God moment. God's spirit is here. Even though we're not screaming or hollering, God is here right now. He's there in your room. You know what I found out? There are so many men before the pandemic that was missing from the church. Now that the pandemic is here, there are so many men that are nowhere near the church. I go on big churches, I go on smaller churches, and this is not a slight to women, because you got that connection. But what I'm saying is, when I go, you look, every time you look, you go and you see all the names. You very seldom, I went to a church, I was looking at a church online, got about 800 people. They had about maybe 70 or 80 people on. I did not see not one man on. Not one man. And you know why that is? Men, if you happen just to be watching today, because you don't want to deal with your issues. You don't want to deal with your fear. You don't want to deal with your insecurities. And this pandemic has taken your fear to another level. And so rather than show your vulnerability, you escape. So you don't have to be accountable to nobody. And nobody will say, this is what you need to do to get your deliverance. Are you hearing me? Now, this is what I want to do. This is just so, I want you to turn around, because I'm not going to pray a prayer with you. I want you to turn around, and if you're at home, wherever, I want you just to turn around and kneel. And I want Tracy to give us some nice, just music. I want you to just turn around and kneel, and I'm not going to do the have the Jesus filled day. But I want you to just turn around and just talk to God. Ask God right now. Even if you need, take out the mirror. Please take out the mirror. As you look at it. And just look in that mirror as you're praying and saying, God, what is it about me that I need to be delivered from so that I can start living like more like a conqueror. And don't just spiritualize it. Oh, I'm not praying enough. I'm not reading enough. You got issues in other areas of your life, your emotions, your social life, your relational life. You have it. And I want us just to talk to God. If you're at home, hallelujah, while you're talking, if you're at home, I just want you to kneel by the bed or by the chair. Or if you're in your car, now if you're driving, that's a different story. Amen. But I just want you to talk to God. And then after you talk to God, after you finish talking to God, I want you to take at least 3 to 5 minutes just to listen. Just to listen. Say, God, what is it about me that make me not trust people? Oh, Lord, what is it about me that I have a hard time with habits. What is it? So I'm going to be quiet. And I want you to talk to God. And if you feel like crying, if you feel like screaming, if you feel like hollering, whatever it is, God is saying enough is enough. I'm tired of my children living like second-class citizens. Come on, talk to him. Because you're struggling. There's somebody, we don't want you to walk away from your marriage. We don't want you to walk away from it. We want you to get help. We want you to acknowledge that there's a problem. We don't want you to be insecure about who you are. You know, I used to have a problem when people would say good things about me. I'm just like, hurry up with your thing, because I can't take it. But I don't feel like that no more. That's why I now let people honor me. Come on, you got to get that junk out. You got to get that junk out. You got to get it out. Now I'm going to go into a silent mode. Maybe you're talking to God about some things. But I want you to be quiet, and I just want you to just say, as you're looking in that mirror or whatever, or and you're looking in that mirror and just say, okay, God, tell me about me. First of all, he got to tell you about you before the problem can be fixed. So right now, we know the solution is Jesus, but God's got a process that he want to take you through. And right now, you've got to get to a place where you say, okay, God, tell me about me. What is it about me that I need some deliverance. I need some change. Tell me about me. I'm going to quiet. know, I hear the Spirit of the Lord saying, He's calling you to a place when you come to Him. Come to Him in quietness. Come to Him in a quiet place where you're not always just bombarding Him about what's going on in your life. But just come to Him in a quiet place and hear His voice. And I hear the Spirit of the Lord saying He's going to begin to give you dreams and visions and revelations. He's going to begin to going to begin to bring people in your life that's going to be speaking words in your life, and He's going to bring restoration. He's going to bring restoration. And I hear from some of the seniors, you have not lived your best life yet. If you could just connect to this, you're just in a new season in your life, and you stop looking at how you used to be in your 50s, 60s, and start embracing where you are in your 70s and your 80s. Start embracing that and saying, okay, God, what is my life supposed to be like as a grandmama or as a grandfather? What my life is supposed to be like as retired? What my life, I hear the Lord just saying, what is my life supposed to be like? And help me to start walking in that. Stop fearing death. Stop hearing, I hear the Lord saying, stop fearing that every time you hear somebody your age, it dies, you start living in fear. Could I be the next person? God has an appointed time for everyone. And if He's ready for you, He will receive you. Stop living your life in fear. I hear the Lord saying, stop living your life in fear. I hear the Lord saying for some people, listen, because I'm getting ready to wrap this up. I hear, listen. It's time for you to get back in church. You've been saying to yourself, I'm afraid of COVID. And I'm concerned about COVID. But this is what He's saying to those. Listen, because some people, it may not be time for you. But for other people, look, you're going every place you want to go but church. And if that's you, you're going every place but church. Every place but church, God is saying it's time for you to come back to Him. And if you don't feel comfortable some place, go someplace where if they practice in social distances and whatever, get somewhere. Now that's what the Lord is saying. Now there's some people, you got health issues and other things. You keep watching online. But there are some people that God is speaking to right now and saying, you have made me secondary. Some people have made God secondary. I'm done. I just need you to share this service with people. Today we're going to put out just the sermon part of it. And then I'm going to put out the long version of just this time that we have. So you may get another thing for this, that, and you need to send it out. And you need to say to people, look, I need you to listen to this. Amen. Come on, baby. Come on. Come on. Come on, we're going to pray for you. Come on. Come on. Amen. Sister Mickles, come here. Come on. Amen. That's right. Oh, God. Come on. Come on right here. Come on, Sister Rosa. Come on, Sister Linda. Come on, Sister Coleman. Come on, Sister Carmella. Come on, I need some ladies. Come on. Oh, God. Come on. We got to get her through this. Hallelujah. We don't have to know everything, but come on. Come on. Y'all just begin to pray. Come on, Sister Keisha out here. Come on, come on, come on. Come on, come on. Come on, I want y'all. Come on, just begin to pray. That's right. Because she got to get it out. Come on. We got to get it out. We got to get it out. We're supposed to look toward one another's interests, and we got to pray. Come on, I need y'all to pray. I know that you're worried about dinner and other things, but this ain't about dinner right now. God said, I'm doing it, and I'm going to do it the way I want to do it. I don't know if you were watching online and you just felt like you needed to come, but hallelujah. Come on, just love on her and just pray for her. Come on, if you need to pray in the Spirit. Come on, I need y'all to pray in the Spirit. I need y'all to pray in the Spirit. Hallelujah. Come on, April. Help me. Come on, I need you to pray in the Spirit. I need some ladies. Come on, just begin to pray in the Spirit. Amen. This Spirit's got to get off of her, and she's got to get her breakthrough. Amen. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. Come here, Christian. Come here. Ryan. I want you to come here. Come here, Ryan. Come here. I want you to pray for Christian. Amen. I want you to, Brother Allen, come on, I want y'all to pray for Christian. I want you to pray for him. Amen. Come on, y'all just pray for him. I want you to pray for him. And to Lord, come on, just pray for him. Oh, that's right. Come on. In the name of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus, God.
That heavy weight.
Hallelujah. Yes. Hallelujah.
Oh, God. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on, Brother Allen, I need you to come and speak into his life. Because you know what it means growing up as a child. You know what you went through. I need you to begin to speak into his life as you're praying. Come on. Come on. Hallelujah. If you're watching, amen. One of our members came, amen, at the end of the service. I felt her pain, and we're praying her through right now. Oh, God. Oh, God. That's right. See, I know when God tells me something. Hallelujah. Come on, just love on it and just pray for it. That's right. Come on, just intercede in the Spirit. Because when we intercede in the Spirit, God, hallelujah, we're praying the will of God. Oh, God. That's right. Come on. We got to get it all out. Oh, God. Oh, God. Yeah, come on, pray her through. That's right. Come on. Right here. I just want you to raise your hand and talk to God about you. Because there have been some challenges. Amen. Don't let the devil play with your mind. Don't listen to him. I knew when you said you wasn't coming, I knew that God said he was going to make a way for you to be here. Because this message was for you. This message is for you. And he's going to help you. He's going to help you in some areas that you need help. I hear the Lord saying, as a man, you can't carry this by yourself, son. I hear him saying, you can't carry this by yourself. You can't do this by yourself. You cannot. You got to make yourself accountable. You need people to talk to. Yes, you got your wife to talk to, but you need to have another man. You need to have somebody that you can trust. Hallelujah. That you can be accountable, that you can be vulnerable with, that you don't have to be afraid that people will use those things against you. Come on, just talk to God right now. This is God's time with you and him. Come on, just talk to him right now. Come on, talk to him right now. That's right. Don't worry about being a man. Don't worry about who's looking at you. Don't worry about it. Just release that. Get that stuff out of you right now. Get it out. Come on, get it out. Come on, get it out right now. 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 That's right. Come on. Love on our sister. Come on. 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 God is in the healing business. God is in the restoration business. God is in the delivery business. God is in the saving business. Hallelujah. Come on. If you're at home, you're watching this long extended version. You at home. Come on. Raise your hand before God and begin to cry out to him. Begin to cry out to him. Come on. Tell him how you're feeling. Tell him what's going on in your life. Tell him how you're feeling right now in the midst of this pandemic, in the midst of the unfulfilled things that have happened in your life, the hurt, the pain, the grieving. Come on, tell him right now. This is you and your God. This is you and your God. This is you and your God. Yes. 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 That is. I hear the Lord just saying accountability. You can't do it by yourself. 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 Yes. 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 Yes, that's right. Come on. Come on. Some things come, you got to pray her through. Come on. Y'all got to pray her through. You're doing it. Come on, but we just got to pray her through. We got to pray her through. Amen. So she can sleep at night. She can have peace at night. Hallelujah. She can know, hallelujah, that she's not by herself, that she ain't got to carry this by herself. Hallelujah. Oh God. 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 Hallelujah. 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 Some people here, if you would just open yourself, your heart up to him, he's just waiting on you. He's not going to force himself on you. He's just waiting on you to tell him how you feel. He wants you to tell him how you feel so that he can begin the healing process in your life. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. 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 Glory. Spirit of the Lord is still here. He's still moving on people. It's yours. Come on, God is still moving. He's still, he's showing, it's a delay in some areas that he's doing. He's working on the pieces. Working on you all. God is teaching George how to appreciate Connie more than you ever have. Tracy, you can turn my mic on. God's moving. God's moving. I don't have to do anything. Hallelujah. But let God move. God is dealing with some people right now. He's dealing with you. Hallelujah. Yes.
Thank you.
praise. Give him praise. Give him praise. Like, give him praise. God is working. God is working. This is not the act of a man. This is the act of God. God's moving among his people.
Thank you.
God's moving among his people.
I gotta say.
God's moving among his people. God's moving. God's moving. God's moving. God's in the house. Moving right now. He's moving right now. Moving right now. He's moving right now. He's moving right now. I hear the word restoration. Hallelujah. Restoration. Restoration. I forget, was it commissioner? Somebody said, restoration has finally come. God is bringing restoration. He's bringing restoration. He's bringing restoration. I hear the word restoration. 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 Oh. Restoration. 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 Oh God. Oh God. Oh God. This is your family. You can't get away from us. This is your family. This is your family. Restoration, God. Just restoration. Restoration. No more hiding. No more hiding. No more hiding. No more hiding. The pain is too bearable for you to bear. No more hiding. No more hiding. No more hiding. Together in the sanctuary, just coming together, loving on one another, encouraging one another. To take your mirror home and put your mirror in a strategic place. Put it in a strategic place so that you can look at it and say, God, where am I in the restoration? Where am I in the restoration of what you're doing in my life? Where am I in that restoration? Where am I in that healing? Where am I in that deliverance? All I can say is this God is just moving, and he's doing what needs to be done. I'm not going to take away from what God is doing for those that are still being ministered to. God's moving. And like I said, you're going to get two versions. You're going to get the version with a longer version. You're going to get the shorter version. And you need to send it out to people. Give them the option. Because God's moving. God can move through video. He can move through live stream. He can move in many ways that he's doing. You have to just see what's going on in the sanctuary, how he's just moving on people. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Yes. Yes. Hallelujah. God, you have your way. Not us, but you. You have your way, God. You have your way, God. Not us, God, but you. You have your way. Not us, but you, God. Not us, but you, God. You have your way. You have your way. You have your way. You have your way, God. Every drop. Every drop, God. Every drop. Every drop. Every drop, God. Every drop. Have your way. Oh, Yeah, like I said, if you must leave, you can. But God is still moving. He's still moving. He's still moving. God is still moving. You can shut the camera down. God is still moving. But he's still moving.